Hello everyone, welcome to the channel Lang and Lit. In today's video, I will be giving you simply explained detailed summary of the chapter We Are Not Afraid to Die If We Are Together from class 11th CBSE syllabus. Before taking up our topic of today, I would like to tell you briefly about my channel. It is a channel dedicated to English studies. It covers wide range of topics from vocabulary building, English in competitions, spoken English, excellent communication skills, and syllabus of class 11th and 12th CBSE. You can have a look at all from the given playlist and the videos. So subscribe to the channel now by pressing the subscribe icon in the red below. Let's begin with our main content. I will give you a comprehensive view of the chapter starting from the author, detailed summary, themes, so keep watching till the end. Let us now see the plot summary of the chapter. In July 1976, the author, who is 37 years old businessman, along with his wife Mary, son Jonathan, who is 6 years of age, and daughter Suzanne, who is 7 years, set a sail from Plymouth, England, for a trip around the world, taking the route that Captain Cook had taken 200 years earlier. So these people have taken a trip from Plymouth, England, and they have tried to imitate the same trip which was taken by Captain Cook 200 years earlier. They had longed to do this for the past 16 years and hence spent all their spare time improving their maritime skills in the British waters. Their boat Waywalker was 23 meters, 30 tons boat, and that had been efficiently built. It had various fixtures and was tested in the roughest weather they could find. So they all were prepared and they were in training for past 16 years. They have been trying their hand. Now they are totally equipped to take this errand. The first part of their 3 years journey passed pleasurably as they sailed down to the west coast of Africa to Cape Town. However, before moving to the east, they took two crewmen, American Larry Vigil and Swiss Herb Selka, to help them across the southern Indian oceans, since this was known to be one of the world's roughest seas. It was just on the second day of their journey to Cape Town that they began to face windstorms that continued for a week. But worse than that was the ferocious winds that were blowing and that rose up as high as the main mast. So the winds were very high. And then what happened was, by 25th December, they had traveled 3,500 kilometers east of Cape Town. The weather was terrible, but that did not stop them to celebrate Christmas. They joyfully celebrated Christmas. By New Year's Day, the weather became worse, and on the morning of 2nd January, the waves were extremely large. They were sailing with only a small storm jib and were still making 8 knots. The ship moved to the top of each wave, but the gigantic waves and the menacing winds continued to terrorize them. So we see that the waves were too high and the ship was actually moving at the top of the wave. So you can imagine how ferocious and how horrible the sight must be. They dropped the storm jib to slow the boat and then lashed a heavy mooring rope in a loop across the stem. Then they fastened everything, went through their life raft drill, attached lifelines, and put on oilskins and life jackets. So they were prepared for this weather. So they put on the life jackets, the children, and these people who were there, the crewmen, and Jonathan, the narrator, and his wife Mary, everybody, along with the small girl Suzanne, they all were wearing life jackets and all. At about 6 p.m., there was a lull before the storm. The wind stopped and the sky became dark. Then a loud roaring sound was heard and a huge cloud seemed to tower over the ship. It was, in fact, the biggest wave that they have ever seen. It was perpendicular and almost the twice as high as the other waves. You can imagine how high that wave must be. The roaring grew louder and the author attempted to ride the waves. But just then there was a great explosion that shook the floor of the ship. Water gushed into the ship. With the impact, the author's head hit against the wheel. Before he was thrown into the sea, he accepted the fact that he was going to die. But suddenly his head popped out of water and he spotted Wave Walker a few meters away. Wave Walker was their ship. It was on the verge of overturning. Its masts were almost horizontal, then a strong wave tossed it to a straight position. The author took hold of the guardrails and reached the Wave Walker. The waves were throwing him around and his left rib cracked. His mouth was filled with blood and he had broken his teeth. So he was in terrible physical pain and anguish at that time. Somehow he found the wheel, lined up the stem for the next wave and hung on. The author felt the ship flooding with water. Just then his wife Mary came in panic and informed him that the ship was sinking as water was filling in. Putting her at the wheel, the narrator clambered towards the hatch. He saw Larry and her pumping out of water frantically. He also noticed that the whole starboard had caved inwards and clothes, crockery, charts, tins and toys were all floating in deep water. So the ship was full of water and everything was floating in deep water. Then the author waded the difficulty into the children's cabin. Sue, as Suzanne was called, had a big bump on her eye, but this was insignificant as compared to the situation they were in. He found a hammer, screws and canvas and struggled back to the deck. Somehow he managed to stretch the canvas and secure waterproof hatch covers across the gaping holes. Some water continued to come in, but most of it could not be prevented from entering the ship. This was not the end of their troubles. The hand pumps started clogging up and the trash floating around the cabins. So the pump was stopping to work, or you can say it was getting choked by the trash. So the electric pump short-circuited. The water level rose. He went to the deck and found two spare hand pumps and another electric pump under the chart room floor. This particular night was extremely cold. They struggled to pump out water, find direction and also work the radio. There was no response to their desperate calls for help because they were in distant corner of the world and the weather was too bad for the radio to catch the signals. Sue's head had swollen a lot. She had two huge black eyes and a deep cut under her arm, but she did not worry him. By morning on 3rd January, they had managed to pump out water to a reasonable level and they could afford to take 2 hours rest in turn. The author suspected a huge leak somewhere and found that nearly all the boat's main rib frames were damaged down the keel. There was nothing holding up a whole section of the starboard hull except a few cardboard partitions. So you can see that not only people but even the boat was in a very terrible condition. By now they knew that their ship Wave Walker was not sturdy enough to take them to Australia. It means that it was not in a good enough state that they could reach Australia, which was their destination. So the author checked the charts and assessed that there were two small islands a few hundred kilometers to the east. One of them was Lie Amsterdam. They hoped to reach one of these safely and for better weather, as their secondary engine was also out of order by now. On January 4, they managed to throw out the water from the ship after 36 hours of non-stop pumping. Now they had to only pump out water that was still coming in. It was difficult to set any sail on the main mast as the pressure was rigging and would pull the broken section of the hut apart. So they hoisted the storm jib and moved towards the two islands. They ate their meal or whatever they were having, they ate it, and some corned beef and cracker biscuits after almost 2 days. You can imagine their pathetic condition. However, their relief was short-lived and came to an end by 4 p.m. Dark clouds gathered there and the wind started blowing fiercely and the sea rose afresh. The situation worsened, and when the narrator tried comforting the children on 5th January, John said that they were not afraid of dying if the family could be together. So this is the title which is mentioned by Jonathan, who, being a small child, he had said that if the family is together, he's not afraid to die. But the author was determined to fight the sea. To protect the weakened starboard, he decided to heave to the undamaged port, hull facing the oncoming waves, using a makeshift sea anchor of heavy nylon rope and 2 22-liter plastic barrels of paraffin. Later in the evening, as more water came into the ship, they felt defeated again. But by morning, 6th January, the speed of the wind decreased. The author tried to calculate their position using a spare compass and by estimating the influence of the westerly currents. After 2 p.m., he asked Larry to steer a course of 185 degrees. He said that they could expect to see the island at about 5 p.m., although inwardly he was doubtful. Dejected, he went down to his bunk and before he knew, he fell asleep. He woke up at 6 p.m. and it was growing dark. Then the two children came to him. Jonathan told him that he was the best father and the best captain. Suzanne announced that the island was just in front of them. The author rushed to the deck and stared with a relief at the Lie Amsterdam. It was there in front of them. It was a piece of volcanic rock with little vegetation. They stayed offshore for the night and the next morning all 28 inhabitants of the island helped them to the island. When at the island, he admired Larry and Herb's happy and positive attitude, Mary for being at the wheel for the critical hours, and but most of all, Sue, who did not want them to worry about the head injury, and Jonathan, who was not afraid to die. Now let's see the difficult words of this chapter and their meanings. The first is voyage, which means a long journey by the sea or space. Leisure, which means free time. Honing, which means to sharpen or improve. Seafaring, regularly traveling by sea. Honing our seafaring skills, it means improving the skills required to travel by sea. Wooden hull, a watertight body of a ship. The next word is gales, which means a strong wind. Mast, the meaning is a tall upright structure on the boat or ship. Next word, atrocious, means bad or very poor quality. Gigantic, huge, or of big size. Jib, a triangular staysail set forward the mast in the ship. Knots, a unit of speed. Enormous, a very large size. Mooring, the ropes. Stern, the back part of the ship. Don't, to put on or to wear. Oilskin, heavy cloth, waterproofed with oil. Impending, it means something which is about to happen. Aft, near the stern of the ship. Frightful, very unpleasant or shocking. Crest, reach the top of the wave. Deck, the floor of the ship. Torrent, a fast-moving stream of water. Smashed, to shatter something. Capsizing, be overturned in water. Hurled, throw with great force. Taut, stretched or pulled tightly. Hatch, door. Bulged swell. Starboard side of the ship, which is on the right side when one is facing forward. The theme of this chapter is, the story We Are Not Afraid to Die speaks about the adventures of a family which is out on a voyage. This story is an encounter described by the author which he experienced while taking the voyage. You will witness a stream of unfortunate events that lead to a disaster for the family living its big dream of sailing. The story brings many emotions which help you to understand the importance of bonding in a family, and you will see how each member of the family perseveres to survive this deadly situation. In this story, all the characters are brave and love each other immensely. This surprise package is the kids who show great courage in such a difficult time and give moral support to their father who's struggling to save everyone. The story represents how courage can help you overcome any situation. It beautifully highlights the struggle of each member of the family and the combined efforts of all the members that help them survive the disastrous event. The story also shows the struggle of a father determined to save his family and leaves no stones unturned to bring the situation under control. It also brings the combined efforts of each character to fight the situation. The little boy, Jonathan, exhibits a great deal of courage and is also ready to die if all his family members are together. All that matters is that they are together. The young girl, Suzanne, is seriously injured but chooses not to bother her father, who's struggling to save everyone. This entire story revolves around the family and their positive attitude, which saved everyone. The whole family stands together and fights the situation with an indomitable spirit. The story shows how unity might help you to overcome the toughest of situations. The family members trust the author and how their faith in him boosts his confidence to fight.